Vidyavardhaka Sangha is running a host of institutions. It is imparting education from primary to PG level, and among them, ours is the college. We are offering education to commerce students as well as computer applications students. So we are running two courses. So all the students are awaiting for your voice. And I told lady will going to speak very much, and she will be dare enough to tell her opinions. And it is a burning topic. You please listen to her voice. So I told it. So I must thank my management for giving me support and encouraging me to organize this kind of webinars. So today, fortunately, we have invited you and you have accepted our invitation. And my faculty, Dr. Lata Mani, will going to invite you, and she will going to welcome you. So thank you very much, madam.
Thank you.
Good afternoon. Good afternoon, madam. Good afternoon, each and everyone.
Yes.
Yeah, good afternoon, each and everyone. We are all present here virtually to attend this one-day national level webinar on the topic euthanasia and the right to die. Do you have such a right in India? The topic itself raises our ideas on it. So anyway, before welcoming madam, I'd like to give a brief introduction related to her. Dr. Varsha Vivekananda is an associate professor in the Department of Law. And do we have it? Is there any technical problem there?
Yeah, you are not very clearly heard, madam.
Banta.
So can I continue?
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Dr. Varsha Vivek Deshpande is an associate professor in the Department of Law of Dr. Ambedkar College, Diksha Bhumi, Nagpur. Having done a graduation, master's degree program, and PhD in the law from the RTM Nagpur University, she turned to academics by virtue of her sheer passion for teaching. Constitutional law and administrative law are her core subjects of specialization. Madam is invited on various occasions in different parts of the country for delivering lectures on a wide range of subjects connected with law, women's rights, and gender equality, constitutional law, human rights, and national security. She has delivered close lectures. Dr. Deshpande is also a faculty member on the panel of the Institute of Military Law, CAMTI, which is the only institute in the country for imparting training in the law for officers in the Indian Army. Her lectures in the said institute have and recognition not only by officers of the Indian Army, but by the army officers of foreign countries as well. In the past year, Dr. Varsha Deshpande has had the rare honor of being invited as a keynote speaker for lectures in the conference of the Fellows of the Ministry Ambitious Fellowship Program in the state of Maharashtra during the regime of Sri Devendra Fadnavis. These lectures were held during the winter session of the Maharashtra State Legislative Assembly. Dr. Deshpande had a good academic record and an active student life herself. She is a gold medalist at the RTM Nagpur University and bagged 4 gold medals for being the university topper. During her student life, she had bagged the prestigious Best Student of the University Award, along with several prizes and medals for the public speech. She is also a recipient of the Orator of the Town Award and the Pride of the Generation. Madam is invited as a professional master of ceremony for several important functions, both governmental and others. She was specially invited to conduct programs of the then Honorable President of India, Her Excellency Srimati Pratibha Devi Singh Patil, His Excellency Dr. APJ Abdul Kalam, the Honorable Governor of Maharashtra, the Chief Minister of Maharashtra, the Chief Justice of India at several places. She is also invited as a judge of many debate and elocution competitions, panelist at mock parliament, etc. She has presented papers in several national and international conferences in themes related to constitutional law. Additionally, she also writes poetry as a personal passion and hobby. Also, her academic lectures on various topics of constitutional law can be found on her YouTube channel by the name of Dr. Varsha V. Deshpande. With this information, I welcome you wholeheartedly for this webinar. I also welcome our respected principal, Dr. M. Shivalinge Gowda, sir, from Sri K. Puttaswamy First Grade College. I also welcome all my colleagues and all the active participants from different parts of India. Welcome once again each one of you for this virtual webinar. Now I request Madam to take over the session.
Thank you very much, Madam. I'd just like you to quickly tell me that am I heard properly? Is there clarity in what I'm talking?
Yes, Madam. Yes, it's there.
Okay.
It's okay. Clear.
Okay. Well, thank you very much to the Puttaswamy First Grade College for having me over once again. Thank you very much to the principal and all the staff concerned. Also, thank you very much, Madam, for that robust introduction that you just gave. It's indeed a pleasure for me once again to be addressing this webinar, but this time on a slightly different topic, which is probably a subject that not many of us really want to discuss or talk about. But nonetheless, I think this is a wonderful platform that the college has created, where we do give ourselves an occasion to talk about something that is deliberately sometimes deliberately ignored or deliberately not brought into public discussions. So I once again welcome all the participants who have joined in for this webinar today. And I passionately hope that the 1 or 1.5 hours, whatever that I have at my disposal, when I would be dealing with this particular topic, I passionately hope that at the end of the session, it would leave something for us, some food for thought, something to ponder about and think about. I hope I leave you with those few questions at the end of the session. Well, to begin with, let's understand that the topic that we have for discussion today is about the right to die in the context of euthanasia. We are going to talk about whether we really do have something like a right to die. Now, probably all of us know that our constitution does give us certain fundamental rights. And one of the very important fundamental rights that all of us have is the right to life. So we do have a right to life, which has been so expansively interpreted by the court on and off in a number of cases that have happened or that have been decided by the Supreme Court. So all of us basically know that we do have a right to life. But the question that we are going to ask ourselves and try to answer today is that fine, we do have a right to life, but do we have a right not to live? Okay, so do we have a right to die? Now, all of us know this, that since we are born as human beings, there is going to be some time that, you know, death is inevitable and all of us are going to die. So we do know the fact that we are born, so we are going to die. But what we do not know is when are we going to die? And the more important question is we also do not know how we are going to die. Okay, so how, when will the end come and how will the end come are questions which, though we do not bring them into discussion, they are questions that concern us. They are questions in which we are interested to at least think about, if not talk about. Okay, and that is a part of this, if I may say so, is what is going to be into discussion today. Okay, so we're going to basically try and pose certain fundamental questions. Number one question being, do we really in India have the right to die? That is the first question. And number two is, if I do have the right to die, when can I use that right, or how can I use that right? Okay, so these are the two basic and fundamental questions that we are framing for inquiry. Do we have a right to die as citizens of India? And number two, if we do have any such right, then when can I use that right? How can I use that right? Is the second question we will try to answer. Now, as I begin this session, probably I would choose to answer the second question first. Okay, that when and how can how can I have that freedom or liberty to make a decision about ending my life? Okay, so is it the case that I'm frustrated with my life, or at this stage of my life itself, I develop a feeling that, okay, I have accomplished all that I wanted to, and I have no further purpose for which I can continue living. So can I act upon my decision to end my life? So, you know, it's that kind of an argument that I'll be making here, and presuming that there's a right that, look, this is my life. And so I would do whatever that I want to do with it. If I want to live, I would live. If I do not want to live, I might as well choose to end my life. Okay. So if at this stage, what is the point of time, or what is the situation in which I can exercise something called as the right to life? Can I do it if I am frustrated out of my life? Can I do it just now if I simply feel that, okay, I have achieved everything that I had wanted to, so there's no further purpose to why I should continue to live? So I exercise my right to die. Can I do it in these kind of situations? The answer is an emphatic no. Okay. Now, when we are talking about the right to die, can I be using this right in terms of, you know, say, for example, committing suicide? I'm frustrated out of a particular situation. So can I end my life because I'm frustrated? Now, that's an example of a suicide. So do we have a right to commit suicide? Answer is no. We do not enjoy any such right in India. In fact, our general criminal law of the country, which is the Indian Penal Code, penalizes an attempted suicide. So it says an attempt to commit suicide is a punishable criminal offense. Now, of course, with the Mental Health Act coming in, it does decriminalize attempted suicide. But that's a topic for discussion on another day. I do not want to mix up these areas. Okay. So for the present, we need to understand this with clarity, that when I talk about a right to die, do I therefore have a right to commit suicide? We do not have a right to commit suicide. That's not the way the Indian system recognizes anything like a right to die. Okay. So if it's not suicide, then what is the kind of cases in which probably I can talk of something like a right to die being available for me as a citizen of India? Okay. Now, in answering this question, I want you to actually imagine a particular situation. Okay. There's a hypothetical situation that I'm constructing in front of you, which I want you to imagine. That suppose there is a person who meets with a very, very fatal accident. Okay? He meets with a very, very fatal accident. He's admitted immediately into the hospitals. The doctors examine him and find him that look find that he's completely unconscious, not responding in any way, probably gone into coma because there's a brain injury. So the doctors put him into the ICU, and eventually the doctors feel the need of putting this person on a ventilator. Okay, so the person is, the relatives of the patient are told this fact that, okay, he's into coma and we cannot predict anything, not responding to anything. So we probably need to put him on the ventilator if we have to save him. So the relatives of the patient, they are in a mindset that, okay, we will do anything and everything that is necessary to save this person's life. And so they say, okay, we place him on the ventilator. So in the hospital bed, in the ICU, the patient is put on a ventilator, which means he's put on a life support. Okay. You have the patients anxiously waiting, patients' relatives anxiously waiting outside the ICU every single day, waiting for the doctor to do the routine visits into the hospital. And when the hospital comes out of the ICU, the relatives ask him very anxiously, what is the progress about the patient? And the doctor says that he's not responding yet. Okay. Imagine that this situation continues for days on end, for months on end. Eventually, you realize that for breathing, the person has been put on a ventilator. So there's a ventilator, therefore the person is breathing and therefore that person is alive. The excretory functions are being performed with the help of a catheter. So there's another instrument that is attached, which is performing the excretory functions. And because the person cannot physically have any intake of food, you realize that, you know, that nasal tube has been inserted through the nose. You insert a tube through which the person is artificially fed. And that's how the person continues to stay alive, not for days, not for months, but probably for years together. Okay. Now, in this situation, if we tend to imagine that the person who has met with the accident and the person who is admitted into the hospital bed, if this person happens to be our own family member, our close relative or our close friend, then trust me, our entire perspective of looking at the situation undergoes a complete change as time passes by. So initially, you know, we are caught up into that zeal that, okay, whatever we would have to do medically, we are ready to do that. So do all that you perceive to be necessary. Now, all that is done, the person is put on life support. And with that life support, the person continues to live not for months, but for years together. And when you reach that particular stage, trust me, as a close relative or as a family member of this patient, your own thought process undergoes a tremendous change with the passage of time. Because when so much time has passed by, somewhere as a person concerned, as a person who's closely and intimately associated with that patient, one starts or one begins to think that, look, it's no sense that a person is living like this. Instead, it would be better off if that person has an easy exit from the world. Okay? Now, this is a kind of situation in which many of us are often caught up. And then it becomes a very difficult decision for us to take. Because here, remember, we are not wanting to eliminate that person from life because we don't want him around. But we want that person to take an easy exit from life instead of having this kind of, a lingering life which is of no meaning either to the person himself, because he doesn't even know that he's alive. There's no sign of active life into such a person. When a person reaches into that stage, probably we begin to think that this is not the kind of life we want to see our own person living. You've seen that person having such a dignified life, and you're now at a stage where you start thinking that please, please, somewhere, you know, we start whispering a prayer that let this person have a dignified exit from the world. And it is in this kind of situation that can something like a right to die be conceived, is the question that we're going to deal with into this session. So when we talk about the right to die, remember, it's not the suicide kind of cases that we're going to look at, but the topic that is framed for discussion today is about euthanasia and the right to die. Do we have any such right in India? So we're going to look at right to die from the lens of the whole idea of euthanasia. Now see, euthanasia, literally speaking, is a Greek word which means dignified death. Okay, so can we have, or do we have, a right to a dignified death? So it's in the context of euthanasia that probably in a marginal sense, I would say, our legal system today does recognize something like a right to die, which is of course subject to a number of conditions and number of procedures that have been listed down by the Supreme Court of India. I would shortly, in the course of this lecture ahead, be talking to you about what those procedures and what those conditions really are. Okay, so to begin with, this is the clarification that I would want to give to all of you, that here we're going to talk about the right to die in the context of euthanasia only. And when you're talking about euthanasia, which is also often called as mercy killing, you know, though I don't really approve of this word, but anyway, that's the word that is often used to address euthanasia. We call it mercy killing, where you're not really, as I said, wanting to eliminate that person from life, but it is out of compassion that you start feeling that, you know, this person is better off being dead rather than having this kind of a life where he's languishing on a hospital bed, not even knowing that he himself is alive, and simply because it is the ventilator that is performing the breathing function for this person, we technically say that, okay, this person is alive. Okay, in these kind of situations, can we allow the adoption of a certain method through which this person is relieved of the kind of situation in which he is, and you allow an easy exit from the world to such a person? That is the question that we are addressing. Okay. Now, when I talk about euthanasia, or when I talk about mercy killing, there are two types of euthanasia, as this is, you know, typically framed. We say there are two ways in which we understand euthanasia. One is what you call as active euthanasia, and another is what you call as passive euthanasia. Okay, active euthanasia would be where some lethal combination is injected into a person, for example, and then once you inject that lethal combination, the poison would spread all across the body and the person would die. But here again, risking repetition, let me point out, even where you're doing this, the idea is not that you want to kill the person. So therefore, it's different from murder per se. Okay, here, even here, your feelings are the same, that you don't want that person to live in so much pain, and so you are wanting his or her life to end. Now, what are the ways in which you can bring this about? One is what I was telling you, active euthanasia, where you actually inject a poisonous combination into the body of a person, the poison is expected to spread in the body and the person eventually dies. Can you do that? The answer again is no, because active euthanasia is impermissible, not just in India, but in almost all countries of the world, because active euthanasia is almost, though, you know, your feelings are different, but it's almost an act of killing. And therefore, active euthanasia is not permissible at all in India, right? So when we're talking about euthanasia and the right to die, can you choose this method of bringing an end to a person's life? The answer is no. Okay. Then is passive euthanasia permissible? Let's try and first understand what is passive euthanasia, right? Passive euthanasia is different from active euthanasia, because here you're not actually engaging into any kind of a positive act of bringing an end to a person's life. So, you know, passive euthanasia can probably be best explained with that hypothetical example with which we started, that, you know, when that person was admitted into the hospital, he would probably had died if we had not, you know, brought in certain medical interventions. So because you wanted to save that person's life at that time, the doctor suggested that he be placed on life support, he be put on a ventilator. And that's why you had this medical intervention, which kind of saved the person's life. Okay, so you put him on a ventilator, you put him on a catheter, you had those feeding tubes inserted inside his nose through which, you know, nutrition was being provided to him. So he is alive today because of this support system is something on which he's placed. Okay, now what does passive euthanasia argue for? Passive euthanasia is a concept whereby you say that, okay, you prolong that person's life initially by allowing the support system to intervene. But now, you know, he's only on life support and technically alive, but for all other purposes, he's actually dead, because the person himself doesn't even know that he's alive. He's not able to respond to any situations, not opening his eyes, not conscious. Okay. So he's alive only because he's on life support, and because it is the machines which are doing, you know, all these jobs for him, respiration, excretion, then nutrition, all these are being done with the aid of certain machines, and that's why the person is alive. So when you no longer want to see that person having this kind of a prolonged life, the question is, can you withdraw this life support and allow nature to now take its own course? Okay, so withdraw life support, which had intervened. Otherwise, the person probably would have died back then. But you intervene through these life support systems, the life support machines. And now the question is, are you allowed to withdraw this life support? Okay, so where you withdraw the life support, you now once again allow nature to take its own course, and depending on what nature decides, that person would eventually die. That's how passive euthanasia operates. Okay, so in active euthanasia, you have an active act of injecting some kind of a poisonous combination in a person, and he dies because of that. In passive euthanasia, what you do is the life support on which you have placed, you have put that person, you simply withdraw that life support and then allow nature to take its own course and decide when that person should have a natural death. Okay. Now, trust me, these kind of situations where once you put your own relative or family member on life support, and when that person is not really responding for days on end, months on end, then you start thinking about the decision of withdrawing life support. Trust me, in real life, this is a very, very difficult decision to take. It subjects the relatives and the family members of the patient into different kind of moral dilemmas, because if I'm taking this decision for my family member, I'm fearing that, you know, is my decision causing the death of my own relative? So there are a lot of ethical and moral questions that can be very troubling questions for the ones who are the decision makers in this. Okay. So coming back to, in what sense is right to die available? It's not available as suicide. It's not available as active euthanasia. Now, passive euthanasia is one domain in which, subject to certain conditions, right to die has now been recognized by the Supreme Court of India. Okay, so when we come back to the first question we had asked ourselves, that do we have a right to die? In a very marginal sense, probably the answer to this question is yes, that we do have a right to die in this particular situation, like the situation of passive euthanasia alone, and that too, it is available only subject to, fulfillment of certain conditions, fulfillment of certain procedures that have been mandated by the Supreme Court of India in its judgment, right? So that's the context in which we talk about the right to die in India. So remember, the right to die or euthanasia, as you call it, is something that you are operationalizing, you're putting into effect only in the context of either terminally ill patients. So, you know, they are ill and they are at the last stages of their life. So look at probably a person suffering from cancer who is at the last stage of his life, or last stage of cancer that is detected. The person is in excruciating pain, and there's really not much that we can medically do to bring that person out of that stage. So euthanasia is something that you talk about in the context of either such terminally ill patients, or you talk about it in the context of persons who are in what we call as a persistent vegetative state. Okay, vegetative state means a person is living like a vegetable, not living the life of a human being meaningfully, okay? But you are just breathing either naturally or because of the life support that's given to you, and that's the reason why you're simply alive. So you're living like a vegetable. That's why vegetative state, and PVS is persistent vegetative state. So where, medical opinion tells you that there's no hope of this person coming back to meaningful life. That is where, you are in a persistent vegetative state where your body is not really functioning like what it is expected to normally function. You're not living the life of a human being at all, but it's a vegetative existence that you have. So euthanasia also is something that you are applying only to these kind of patients. Either the patient is terminally ill, or the person is in a persistent vegetative state. In these cases, can you take a decision to withdraw life support? Okay, so in as an answer to that question, today probably in India, we can say that yes, this decision can be legally taken because passive euthanasia has received a marginal recognition at the hands of the Supreme Court. I'm using the word marginal here because this has been conditioned by a number of, procedural safeguards that need to be observed if you want to give effect to this particular decision of withdrawal of life support. Okay, I'm going to very shortly come to that particular aspect. Now, see, when we are talking about euthanasia right to die in the context of euthanasia, in India, the Supreme Court of India was confronted with this specific question about euthanasia. Now, see, we did before, in a number of cases, we did talk about right to die in the context of suicide. And the court in a 5-judge bench decision in a case called Gyan Kaur versus the state of Punjab, the court gave us a decision that, you do not have anything like the right to die in the context of suicide. So there, when the court was evaluating this right to die, it was doing it in the context of suicide, and it said that no such right to die is available to any person in India, right? So that had been the opinion of the Supreme Court in the context of suicide. But for the first time, euthanasia per se came for came for decision before the Supreme Court in the year 2011, when Aruna Shanbhag's case came up before the court for decision. Okay, this was a case called Aruna Shanbhag versus the Union of India, decided by the Supreme Court of India in 2011. Right, so this was the first public interest litigation before the Supreme Court of India that concretely brought the question of euthanasia for decision on the table of the court. Okay, now what happened in the Aruna Shanbhag case? Probably some of you might be already knowing that Aruna Shanbhag was a nurse in the KEM Hospital of Mumbai. Okay, she was working as a nurse there. Now what happened one day was a ward boy from the same hospital, that is the KEM Hospital in Mumbai, a ward boy, when this nurse Aruna Shanbhag was about to leave after finishing her duty and she went into the parking basement, one ward boy from the same hospital attempted to commit a rape on her. Okay, and in the course of doing that, what he did was he strangulated Aruna Shanbhag with an iron chain, right? It was a dog chain with which he tried to strangulate her. And as a result of that, the supply of oxygen to the brain got obstructed. And Aruna Shanbhag, because of that, entered into a state which was similar to the persistent vegetative state, PVS. Okay. Now, when this incident happened, when that ward boy attempted a rape against her and he did this, Aruna Shanbhag was admitted into the same hospital. Her family members abandoned her. Okay. So they broke all their ties with her. They abandoned her. There were no relatives to look after her, no family members to attend to her. And she remained on the hospital bed of the KEM Hospital in Mumbai for 38 long years in a persistent vegetative state. Okay. It was not technically speaking a PVS, but what the medical report said was it's a state that is similar, almost similar to PVS. Okay. So she remained languishing on the hospital bed for so many years. And as I told you, you know, her excretory functions were performed with the help of a catheter. The feeding tubes were inserted through her nose, and that's how she was artificially fed. She could not see with her eyes. She could not properly hear. All her fingers, you know, because of some kind of arthritis that she caught up, she could not move these fingers. She could not speak, and she could not recognize anyone around her. Probably this was something that was open to doubt, that whether she even knows that she is alive and that she's living. Now, this is the state in which Aruna Shanbhag continued to live on one hospital bed into that hospital for 38 long years. Okay, she actually lived for 40 plus years in that condition. But in 2011, when this matter was before the court, at that time, it was 38 years since which she was languishing on that hospital bed. And the nurses, the other nurses of the KEM hospital, were her caretakers who would feed her through the tube and you know, clean her bed and stuff like that. Now, there was one lady called Pinky Virani. This Pinky Virani was actually writing a book on Aruna Shanbhag's life. Okay. And that is where she came to know of these kind of inner details about her life. And so Pinky Virani, on behalf of Aruna Shanbhag, went to the Supreme Court of India. She filed a public interest litigation before the Supreme Court of India, brought this pathetic condition in which Aruna Shanbhag was living for the past so many years. Imagine a woman whose family has abandoned her. There are no relatives, no friends who are coming to see her or take care of her. And she's simply living because she's breathing, not even knowing, not even recognizing anyone around her, and probably not even knowing that she's alive herself. So Pinky Virani filed a public interest litigation before the Supreme Court of India. And what does Pinky Virani pray to the court? What does she ask the court? She tells the court that, look, this is the condition in which this woman is living. And therefore, it's of no sense that, she continues living like this, having a prolonged living like this, which is of no meaning to anyone, including herself. So she tells the court, kindly issue orders allowing the withdrawal of nutrition to Aruna, which she was, artificially fed through those tubes. So she prays before the court and tells the court that, look, kindly issue an order which allows the KEM hospital to stop feeding Aruna Shanbhag through those tubes so that eventually Aruna Shanbhag would starve, and ultimately out of that starvation, she would die one fine day. Okay, so that was the kind of prayer that Pinky Virani makes to the court. So it was a prayer, if you go to carefully look at it, it was a prayer about withdrawal of one kind of a life support, that she could not even eat normally with her hands like most people usually do, most of us always do. So she had to be fed through those tubes that were inserted. That's what you call as artificial feeding, okay? So this prayer was made by Pinky Virani before the court that, look, her life is of no meaning. She's been languishing on one bed of this hospital. So I think it is better off and in her own interest that she's allowed to die and take an exit from the world. So she asks for orders from the court for withdrawing nutrition to Aruna Shanbhag. Now, in that case, in Aruna Shanbhag's case, for the first time, this Am I heard now?
It's clear.
Am I audible? I think I was just out of the platform.
For a few seconds it was like that. Now it's clear, madam. You can continue.
Okay, fine. So coming back to what I was trying to tell you, this was the kind of prayer that Pinky Virani made for Aruna Shanbhag. Now, for the first time, the Supreme Court of India got an occasion to specifically look into situations of mercy killing. Because before this, whenever it had to address right to die, it was in the context of suicide, not in the context of euthanasia. Okay. Now, a division bench of the Supreme Court of India in Aruna Shanbhag allowed passive euthanasia again subject to certain conditions. Okay, so remember, this was a division bench verdict of the court. Division bench meaning there were two judges of the Supreme Court who gave this decision for the first time in India, saying that yes, in these kind of cases, you can have a right to die. But it's only passive euthanasia that you would be dealing with. Again, risking repetition, let me tell you, active euthanasia is not allowed because it is considered to be the parallel of murder. Okay, so the technical distinction which is often drawn, now all of us could debate about whether that's right or wrong. But normally, all scholarship on this subject tells you that the major difference between active and passive euthanasia is active euthanasia is killing whereas passive euthanasia is letting a person die. So, you know, that's the distinction in which this is looked at. It's killing versus letting die, because in passive euthanasia, what you do is simply remove the life support and then nature will decide when that person's life must come to an end. But in active euthanasia, it is considered to be an act of killing. And so even though your decision is driven by compassion for the person, it's still not allowed in any part of India. And in almost all countries of the world, active euthanasia is considered to be a criminal offense. Okay. So the point to which I was coming, this was for the first time in 2011 that the Supreme Court of India did allow passive euthanasia in these kind of situations, but again said that this would be subject to certain procedures that we are laying down in the text of the judgment itself. So if you open the judgment of Aruna Shanbhag in the original and try to read the judgment, you will actually see the court giving you a list of things that have to be done by way of procedures. So, you know, you will see 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. The court gives you a list of guidelines and tells you that, look, if you want to withdraw life support, these things are what you would have to follow. So 2011 probably marked the entry of it marked the legal recognition of passive euthanasia in India. However, for certain reasons, Aruna Shanbhag's judgment was considered to be incorrect judgment. Now, that was for technical legal reasons, which I would not bring into discussion right now, because they are technical constitutional law principles. So I don't want to navigate this discussion in that direction. So the point is that there were a lot of questions that were raised about the correctness of the verdict that the court gave in Aruna Shanbhag's case. Okay. And after Aruna Shanbhag, that is after 2011, you had another case in 2018, which was also in the nature of a public interest litigation, where the question of euthanasia came up before the Supreme Court for the second time. Okay, so after Aruna Shanbhag, there was a PIL that was before the court. In fact, that PIL was filed way back in 2005, but then that was referred to a larger bench of the Supreme Court, and that bench heard that particular matter and gave its decision in the year 2018. To be more precise, it was the 9th of March 2018 when we got the judgment in this particular public interest litigation, which is a case known by the name of Common Cause, a Registered Society versus the Union of India. Okay, so that's the name of the case. Just in case any of you is interested in browsing through Google and finding out what that case is, the name of the case is Common Cause, a Registered Society versus the Union of India, where a 5-judge bench of the Supreme Court of India went extensively into various questions that arise and which have been indeed very, very troubling questions for courts all across the globe, because questions on euthanasia have not been very easy questions for any court to really solve and come about with a verdict. Okay, so the Indian Supreme Court, these 5 judges who were on the bench of the Supreme Court, they went into very intricate questions, different moral dilemmas that arise, different kind of legal questions that come up for consideration. They went into all this and delivered their judgment on the 9th of March 2018. And if you look through the judgment, there are 5 different opinions, 5 different judgments of 5 judges that are written down. All of them, of course, are concurring. So you don't have any majority-minority decision. They're concurring judgments written by 5 different judges, all of them agreeing to the position that passive euthanasia should be recognized in India, subject to certain formalities which they have written down into the judgment. Okay. Now, before I come to talk about what are these safeguards, which I've been mentioning almost 4 to 5 times since I started this session, before I come to talk about what those procedures are, let me quickly pause here to talk about what are the considerations in the minds of the court. When the courts, not just in India, but as I said, courts in most democracies of the world, when they had an occasion to look into questions of euthanasia, what were the major grounds or what were the major issues on which these questions were attempted to be answered? Okay. Now, see, when you're talking about passive euthanasia, one trouble about it, see, when I say or when I'm arguing for allowing a person to die in cases like in euthanasia, admittedly, I am doing that in order to ensure that the person concerned has a dignified death. Okay, so like you talk about life with dignity, you also argue for death with dignity, right? So in the legal world, how do you frame these arguments? The first argument, as I tried to tell you a while ago, was that when you assert, when you say that you have a right to life, does that include a right not to live as well? Because if you open the text of the Constitution and you look at different provisions of fundamental rights, no article in the Constitution is talking about any such right to die. Okay. So textually, you clearly do not have such a right coming from the text of Part 3 of the Constitution. So what the courts try to evaluate is that, look, the court, the Constitution does give us a right to life. So when I have a right to life, does that include a right not to live as well? So, you know, it's similar to when I say I have the freedom of speech. When I have the freedom of speech, it means, I would speak if I want to, but I would not speak if I do not want to. So right to silence is a dimension of right to speech. That's the way we look at that freedom. You apply the same analogy here and ask yourself the question that, look, if I have a right to life, does it include a right not to live as well? Okay, so that's the way this question comes to be framed. And when our courts on a case-to-case basis have interpreted right to life, they have gone into a very, very expansive way in which they can read right to life. So they say that, look, right to life does not mean mere animal existence, but it includes anything and everything that is necessary for a person to have a dignified human existence. So remember, the emphasis of the court consistently while interpreting the right to life has been on dignified life. So I'm simply alive, I'm breathing, therefore alive, and therefore right to life is not the way the court chooses to look at this. It says that, look, right to life will include anything and everything that is necessary to enable a person to live a life with human dignity. Okay? Now, once I say that right to die or right not to live is a part and parcel of the right to live itself, then probably, that leaves scope for me to make an argument about dignified death as well. So if I have a right to live with dignity, I also have the right to die with dignity. So I do not want to have a lingering life where my existence is of no meaning to myself or to anybody else. I don't want to have this kind of, I don't want to, live in a situation where I would be simply lingering my life and languishing on a hospital bed, depending on all kinds of machines around. Okay. Therefore, I want to take a dignified exit from the world, and therefore we talk about living and dying with dignity. Okay. And because it is dying with dignity, that's one of the major reasons why I don't approve of the word mercy killing, as I said before. Where you're talking about mercy being shown on someone, I don't think mercy and dignity actually can go together. But anyway, that's also besides the point. Okay, so we are basically arguing here for a dignified death for a person. Now see what happens is, where does the complication come in? Complication comes in suppose a person who is unwell, if that person himself is conscious, if that person himself is competent to take a decision, probably no problems will arise, because then that person himself would tell you that, look, don't put me on the ventilator, don't do these things with me, don't subject me to these kind of treatments. So you have the opinion of that person himself that is available for you, right? But the complications would increase when the person whose life you're talking about or whose death you are discussing is neither competent nor conscious to make a decision for himself. So if a person is in coma, for example, that person's opinion is not available for you. And so it is the relative of the patient or the family member of the patient who is forming an opinion about the living or dying of that particular person. And that is where probably major complications would arise. Okay. So you are, you know, if I'm talking about my own family member for whom a judgment I'm making, then probably it is just, you know, this anticipation that, okay, I'm quite sure that person would not have liked to live such a life. And so I'm speaking for that person and therefore end his life. So this is something we call a substituted judgment, that somebody else is making a judgment for the life of another person. Right? And that is where the major problem or the controversy about euthanasia arises. If the person is himself conscious, himself competent to take a decision, there's no issue at all. The person can take the decision and that decision can be acted upon. Okay? Now, it is in these kind of situations where you have to make a substituted judgment. That is where the problem arises. Now, what have been the considerations before courts all across in deciding these kind of cases? Number one, typically the courts have been saying in almost all countries of the world where questions of euthanasia came up, the courts have been saying that, look, we have to respect the autonomy of the person. So if it's my life, it's my autonomous decision about whether I should live or not live. So person's autonomy is to be considered. Number two, which is something on which a great weightage has been placed by the courts, is the best interest of the person concerned. Okay, so the court will make a judgment about what is it that is in the best interest of that person. Is it in the best interest of that person that he continues to live? Then you know, you don't intervene in any way. Is it in the best interest of the person that he actually dies? That is a judgment which others are called upon to make. Okay. And now, therefore, coming back, if I with this background bring you back to the judgment of the court in the common cause case, what does this common cause case actually decide for us? There are two major takeaways from the judgment which concern all of us as human beings. What are those two major takeaways? Number one, what the court said in common cause was similar to what it had said in Aruna Shanbhag, that, okay, passive euthanasia in these kind of cases alone, that is where a person is suffering from a terminal illness or he is in a persistent vegetative state, in those kind of cases, passive euthanasia can be allowed, okay? So it recognized passive euthanasia is the first major thing that the court did. And number two, which is very, very important for all of us to know, is that Common Cause, a registered society versus Union of India, is a case which for the first time recognized something called as advance directives. That is what it recognized in this particular case. I'll tell you what advance directives are and what did it actually recognize. Okay. Now, just a minute, please. Now, the kind of situation that I was trying to tell you, which is actually a difficult situation, where the person himself is not available to give you his autonomous decision, and then that decision is to be taken by the family members or relatives of that particular patient. Now, this creates a lot of difficulties, right? To ease out these difficulties, the Common Cause case for the first time recognizes the concept of advance directives, okay? What are advance directives? Some people also choose to call it as living wills, okay? Will is normally something that I write down which talks about what should happen to my property after I am dead. So a normal will, as we understand, is something that comes into effect after I am dead. But living will is something that comes into effect while I'm still alive, but it tries to resolve certain questions about the manner in which I should die. Okay. So what is an advance directive? It is a direction I can write down in advance of how should I be dealt with if at all at any time in future I slip into a persistent vegetative state or I get terminally ill. Okay. So while a person is healthy, while a person is competent, is conscious to make certain decisions, at that time itself, a person can write down on a piece of paper, suppose I feel that if at all this situation is something I'm confronted with tomorrow, and I'm no longer going to be conscious to communicate what I want, how do I want you to deal with me? I can write down on a piece of paper and keep this, that how should I be treated? If I feel that, look, you should not put me on a ventilator at all, maybe I can write that down. Or maybe if I say that I do not want you to subject me to any kind of invasive medical procedures, I can probably write that down. So you're giving directions about how you should be dealt with in advance. And that's why they are called as advance directives. Okay. So this is something which got a legal recognition now with the judgment that came on the 9th of March, 2018. The court recognized advance directives and said that, look, if these advance directives are available, then whenever that situation comes when you've got to take that decision, we will respect the autonomy of that person by giving effect to what he has written down into these directives, right? So this is one major thing that the judgment did. It gave a legal recognition to advance directives. Now, the judgment also gives you guidelines about how you can make an advance directive. So it says the executor will write this down on a piece of paper in the presence of two witnesses who preferably must be independent witnesses. So you will have to have the signature of these independent witnesses on that living will that you're making. That would have to be registered with a jurisdictional JMFC. So JMFC is Judicial Magistrate First Class. And in every district, they would have to, recognize a particular JMFC to be the jurisdictional JMFC for these kind of cases. So you would go to the JMFC, Judicial Magistrate First Class, have that advance directive registered there. A copy of it will be kept in the physical as well as the digital format with the JMFC. Then the JMFC would forward that advance directive and keep one copy Also in the registrar's office of that particular district, they would be nominated to be designated as the relevant officer with whom the custody of that advance directive would have to be kept. And one copy of it would also have to be with the local authority of that particular area. So whether it is panchayat or municipalities, municipal corporations, they would be designated officers who would have these advance directives kept with them in both physical as well as digital format. So that is what the judgment talks about. How do you write down this advance directive? And of course, the two people who are going to sign as witnesses will also have to testify that this has been written by the person in a sound state of mind without any kind of coercion operating on their minds and stuff like that. So that is just to ensure that it is truly an autonomous decision that a person is making. Okay, so this is one important takeaway from the judgment. Now, the second important takeaway is what do you really do when the time comes for you to act on this directive, right? That suppose a person has written down an advance directive, registered it in the way that the court has talked about, and the occasion arises when you need to actually act upon that advance directive. So how do you go about it? Now, here comes the whole cobweb of procedures that the court is prescribing. Now, I will talk to you about and tell you what these procedures are. And at the end of it, we will come to analyze the judgment and the good and the bad of the judgment, right? Now see, these procedural safeguards which the court is giving us these are all motivated by the desire that you want to prevent an abuse here, that nobody should misuse this opportunity and push a person into dying. That's the whole motivation with which the court actually gives you these procedural safeguards. So what are these safeguards? Number one, it tells you that whenever a person wants to act on the advance directive that the patient has written down earlier, he would first intimate the physician who's treating the patient, okay, that such and such advance directive has been written, and he said that we don't subject him to these kind of procedures. So we want to withdraw life support on which we may have kept him, right? Once the physician who is treating the patient comes to know of this, he would get this ensured from the jurisdictional JMFC that the advance directive which the relative is talking about is a genuine document, okay? Because it's going to be registered with the JMFC. So that is one first thing that the physician would have to do to ensure the genuineness of the advance directive that is being produced by the relatives concerned. Okay. The second thing would be the hospital that is treating the patient would have to constitute a medical board. Okay. Medical board comprising of three doctors who are specialists in the given fields. They have specified certain fields like neurology, psychiatry, then oncology, all these people from any of these fields who have minimum 20 years of experience in the field, a board of such senior doctors would be constituted. This board would come and examine the patient and give their opinion about whether it's a right decision, medically speaking, to withdraw life support. Okay, and they would communicate that decision to the hospital concerned. After this stage, what is the next stage that comes in? The next stage would be that the hospital would have to approach the collector of the district, and that collector's independent medical board would be constituted, again comprising of three doctors from any of these fields which are specified in the judgment. And the important rider is that the three doctors who were there in the hospital's medical board would not be the same ones in the collector's medical board. So these are independent doctors independent boards also. Okay, so the collector constitutes a medical board of his own, and these doctors in the collector's medical board would also go and examine the patient, find out if what has happened. Okay, sorry for that, maybe some disturbance that came in between. Yeah, so find out whether it is a genuine case of withdrawal and submit their opinion. So this is going to be opinion number two that is submitted. Okay, if both these boards have agreed to the withdrawal of life support, then the hospital concerned will intimate to the JMFC, with who is the designated JMFC. That JMFC will come to the hospital and visit, make sure that the case is genuine, satisfy himself that there is no use of any kind of mental coercion, mental compulsion and stuff like that, no kind of abuse, and then the JMFC would actually give the decision of allowing the withdrawal of life support. Okay, so this is the kind of procedure that the judgment prescribes, where firstly you intimate the physician, then the physician would have to talk to the family members, giving them a complete idea about his physical condition, what kind of medication is available, what kind of treatments are available, what are the pros and cons of the treatment, give them the entire picture and ask them that even after knowing this, do you want to go by what the advance directive prescribes, or if there's no advance directive, do you want to go by the decision of withdrawing life support? This is what the physician does. Then the hospital's medical board is constituted, where three doctors come and examine the patient and give their opinion. This is called as the preliminary opinion. Then you have the collector's medical board that would be constituted. They would come and examine the patient and give their independent expert opinion. Okay. Then the JMFC would pay a visit to the hospital and make sure that everything is genuine. There's no abuse, there's no misuse going on here. And if he's satisfied, then an order can be passed allowing withdrawal of life support. Okay. Now, this whole procedure goes on provided both boards that you have spoken about have given a unanimous opinion that, look, you can withdraw the life support. But suppose in this case, it so happens that one board said that you can withdraw, but another board said that no, we can still try giving some treatment to the patient. And still the family members want that the life support should be withdrawn, or that you act on the advance directive given by the patient. Then you can petition the High Court, file a petition in the High Court, like what had happened in the Anuna Shanbhag case. So you file a petition before the High Court and ask the High Court for a direction in the matter. Okay. But now what the judgment says is, if such a petition does come up before the High Court, before passing an order, would also constitute another independent medical board of itself, comprising of three different doctors again. Now, those doctors in that medical board would come and examine the patient, submit its opinion to the High Court, and if they say that, okay, you can go ahead with withdrawal of life support, then the court would pass an order and life support can be withdrawn. Now, that is the kind of procedure that the court prescribes for recognizing or allowing passive euthanasia in the country. Okay. Now see, if you look at this common cause judgment, probably I'm going to hold you for just another 5 to 10 minutes and then I'll wind up, because it's already more than an hour that I've been addressing you. If you look at this judgment in the common cause case, there are both perils as well as promises. Okay. What is the promising aspect of the common cause judgment? Promising aspect is, number one, you recognize advance directives. Number two, you are creating a scope for autonomous decision of the person concerned to be acted upon. Okay, because still advanced directives were recognized. We did not know of people who could keep this in a written form and inform the family members and tell them that this is my choice about my life, and that's why I will want you to act in accordance with this whenever that occasion comes. You had no scope for doing this till now. That is a scope that the court has now created with recognizing advanced directives. Okay. Number two, the good part of it is that, okay, passive euthanasia has been recognized in India. So in cases where it is really painful for the person to continue living, you do have a scope for the person to end his life. But the most problematic part, according to me, of this judgment is that though it does go 10 steps ahead in terms of recognizing autonomous choices, in terms of giving weightage to personal autonomy and recognizing passive euthanasia, if it goes 10 steps ahead for doing this, it probably comes 20 steps backward with the kind of burdensome procedure that it has weaved for recognizing passive euthanasia. You know, I do understand the concern of the court that it wants to make sure that this is not going to be misused. But the trouble is, when on one hand you're trying to say that, okay, it's the autonomy of the individual that we want to uphold, it is his decision about his life that we want to uphold. So you're giving a premium to individual autonomy, but in terms of giving effect to that autonomy, you are conditioning the whole thing into such difficult and time-consuming procedures that probably before the person dies, his autonomy is already dead. Because, you know, look at the time you're going to take for the hospital to constitute the first medical board. It gives its opinion after examining the patient. Then you go to the collector. The collector will constitute its own board, taking its own sweet time to do that. Those doctors would come and examine the patient. If they concur, if you're fortunate enough that they concur, then probably you can withdraw. But if you're not that fortunate, then in that state of mind where you're already disturbed with your family member ailing on bed, in the midst of that, you have to run to the high court with a petition. They will constitute their own board, bring three new doctors into picture, and those doctors are going to give an opinion. And mind you, all these are doctors not of my choice. So they are people who probably I don't even know. And they are coming down to examine my patient and give a decision about whether that person can continue living or should die. So there's a terrible depersonalization in the process. You are creating layers of, the so-called safeguarding procedures, where one board after another is coming down to check the condition of the patient and then trying to form their own opinion. Now, in this whole process, I wonder where the autonomy of that person has really gone, because it's their decision more that's going to be given a weightage than the decision of the person who's written the advance directive, right? So this is the rather problematic part of the judgment. And mind you, this procedure that is given into the judgment is not just a burdensome in terms of procedure. I think it is also emotionally burdensome. And then, I forgot to talk about this, that where, you know, one part of the procedure says that after the two boards have agreed, the JMFC himself will come pay a visit into the hospital, check everything is fine or not. Now imagine, you know, we know that we are a country where the judiciary is already overburdened with its own pending cases. Now, when it is so much overburdened with its own work, I wonder when is the JMFC expected to have the time and the interest to get up from the court, come into the hospital, pay a visit to the patient, and then find out whether everything is fine or not. So this makes it, though we are happy that passive euthanasia has been recognized by the court, but probably the procedure is going to remain the intimidating part, where we would not want to go through this entire time consuming and burdensome procedure. You know, you've seen how many doctors are involved. Firstly, you have your own treating physician, you have the three doctors of the hospital board, three another doctors of the collector's board, three doctors of the court's board, if at all that needs to be constituted. And all these doctors are going to be senior doctors from specialized teams. I wonder when are they going to have the time to come and check and give their opinion. For all these visits that the doctors are going to do, who's going to pay them the fees for doing that? Is this the relatives of the patient? How many doctors' fees are going to be paid for doing that? You have 3 plus 3 plus 3 and 1. So you have 9 plus 1, 10 doctors involved in the process of decision making. When are they going to find the time and how many fees would they demand? Would they agree basically to be a part of the board that is going to give a kind of controversial opinion? Because tomorrow the doctors would feel that tomorrow maybe my opinion is going to be challenged by some of the relatives in the courts of law. So are they going to agree to become a part of this board? If at all they do, who is going to bear the economic burden of paying their fees? These are all things which probably have not been anticipated by a judgment that is shrouding passive euthanasia into this cobweb of procedural difficulties. Okay. And personally, as I end this session, if you ask for my personal opinion, I am of the firm opinion that these are certain domains where the law should choose to leave me alone. I'm not really in favor of the law intervening into these kind of private and intimate judgments, because let's always remember, you know, having a law has not really solved our real life problem. That depends on investment on agencies which are outside control. And that is why I think these delicate emotional matters should be best left for a silent understanding between the relatives of the patient and the treating doctors, so that we do not really have these complications in place. Because, you know, see, once the law intervenes and once the law comes in, you have no option but to follow what the law prescribes. So my personal opinion is best is to leave the matters outright opinion of the law. Thank you very much for being patient with me. And it's been a pleasure to address me on this topic. Thank you very much.
Good afternoon, madam. First of all, for the selection of the topic is the relevant one and the most interesting one. And anyway, you have already covered the topic extensively, and we have very few questions to pose before you.
Yes.
First one, and the first simple important question is that one. Is euthanasia a mercy killing or murder? Why I'm asking this question is that Indian Penal Code Section 304 says that euthanasia is offense, and Indian Penal Code Section 304 says mercy killing is murder. In the backdrop of this one, we want to know your opinion. Is euthanasia mercy killing or murder?
Well, I think I have in a way already covered this particular thing, but just in case, because the question is posed, I just want to address it. That, you know, mercy killing or euthanasia is not so. Most distinctly, we have time between euthanasia and murder. What is equated with murder? Okay, so where a victim is injected with some poison chemical, and that is considered murder. But passive euthanasia is not looked upon as an equivalent of murder, right? Because there is no active engagement required in terms of online. There's a difference at the level of intentions as well, number one. And number two, the method in which the end is brought about. So what we're doing in passive listening is only withdrawing what you had, which you're allowed to implement, and then by withdrawing that, giving to make your choice of when nature wants to bring the end. So that is why passive listening is not looked upon as an equivalent of murder, but active listening is, and which is the reason why passive is not legal in India.
Madam, we have learned that one. Netherlands is the one country.
Yes, Netherlands has recognized.
Is legalized, yes, long ago.
Yes.
And it is learned that after that euthanasia was legalized in Netherlands, it led to severe decline in the quality of care of terminally ill patients.
Yes.
And people are apprehensive in our country also. The state and the central governments may refuse to invest in healthcare sector.
Yes.
Taking that one as an example.
Correct. There are a number of problems that are associated with recognizing euthanasia. So apart from, you know, I would not even go as far to talk about state's engagement with healthcare. That is no doubt something that is going to be affected. But, you know, look at more intimate things. Like, you could have a situation where, you know, the close relatives of a patient would actually start wishing that the person must opt for death. Because, you know, caretaking of a patient is something that's not a very pleasant task. And even otherwise, you know, as a person advanced up in age, there's a sense of dependence in others not liking. Are caregivers actually wishing that I can talk to them? So these kind of emotional pressures would also operate on that particular person in terms of taking the end of life decision. So this is, that is why they say you can call the double-edged sword. In the way you look at it, there is a problem. So it's not a very easy thing to handle.
And madam, the right to assisted suicide.
Yes.
Assisted suicide, is it a protection of autonomy or an open door to social killing?
Are you talking about physician-assisted suicide?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, see, physician-assisted suicide, what you're doing is you're using the medical expertise of the doctor in terms of understanding what kind of lethal dose is to be given to the person to bring about to the end of that person's life. But I think here that person will not arise because you are going to that actually child will be out.
Madam, in our country, we do not have well established healthcare system.
Yes.
And limited resources of healthcare we have, and the poor and the minimum number of primary healthcare centers. And in this backdrop, isn't it the time for India to evolve a legal and well-defined procedure to monitor passive euthanasia?
I couldn't hear the last part of the question. Can you just repeat the last part of what you said?
Isn't it the time in our country, India, to evolve a legal and well-defined procedure to monitor this passive euthanasia? As healthcare system is not good in our country.
Well, you know, again, we come down to the same thing, that if you want a legal procedure, to monitor euthanasia. Whether it is through, a procedure that is given by the court, or it is a procedure that is given through a law. As of now, there is no law which our parliament has enacted to govern passive euthanasia, right? So as of now, where does the law governing this come from? It comes from the judgment of the court, right? But as I told you, that was my personal opinion, that these kind of procedural safeguards, which are so-called safeguards, are somewhere trying to complicate the issue, because they subject you to a number of procedures which are very difficult for you to observe. Now the question is, do you want to remove the regulation of passive euthanasia? I think we have to have a procedure that that recognizes these benefits very well. You're taking care of living up to the autonomy of the person. We're not making the procedure really difficult for the caregiver, and also taking account of the healthcare system. The procedures through which the person's pain can be reduced and stuff like that. It will have to be a holistic procedure. It can't be the kind of procedure that we right now have, at least in now our community.
Madam, in your presentation, you gave an example of that Aruna Shanbag,
yes,
who was in a vegetative state for nearly 42 years.
Yes.
Such a case, who can guarantee to take a decision when such people's kind of psychological and mental aptitude of the state are not in a good position to, they are not in a good position to take decision? Who has the sole right to take a decision? In case of Aruna Shanbag, that lady who written about that Shanbag take a decision. In general. So
that is precisely the issue, that in Aruna Shanbag's case, you have no way of, procuring what Aruna Shanbag's own decision on that was. You did not understand what was her choice, whether she wanted to live, continue living like that, or such a life. So when you do not have any of the opinion of that person, then the judgment is judgment with somebody else. It's either the relative or the family member, or and that is where the first So the person can write down, even while he is young, a person could write down on a piece of paper how he or she could be dealt when one reaches that stage, when that advanced direction. That is therefore, I think, part of the judgment that I want you to know what I think wants.
But one last question from our side. It's only out of curiosity. Yes. Can a normal person?
Yeah.
Who is he is in a good condition, not okay, in a vegetative state, or not facing any kind of health issues, or request for euthanasia?
No. That is why I said this in the beginning, that this is something you can bring into operation only when either you are terminally ill or you are in a persistent vegetative state. Nowhere beyond this. So it cannot be the case that just now I think that, okay, I'm done with everything, now I want to end my life. We can't do that. That will amount to suicide because you are not comfortable under the law.
Okay, madam. Thank you for your nice presentation. As we have already
told you that they have selected a beautiful and interesting topic, and most of our participants loved that topic, and they expressed their happiness, satisfaction after with your presentation. Thank you for your nice presentation and sparing your valuable time with us. In spite of your busy schedule, you have with us for the past 2 hours. Thank you once again on behalf of the management for Vidyavardhaka Sangha. And I thank our management, more specifically, that Kundappa Gowda sir, President Vidyavardhaka Sangha, and Secretary Engineer P. Vishwanath, who are always with us when we are organizing any kind of academic program like this one. And I thank all my faculty and principal sir, who are always inquisitive in organizing the academic program like this one. And I thank all the participants who are always with us and who joined whenever we are organizing any kind of webinar like this one. Once again, I thank you, madam, and I thank all the participants. Thank you, madam.
Thank you very much. It's been a pleasure to be a part of this webinar. Thank you.
Thank you.
So I would leave the meeting now. Thank you.
Yes, sir. Okay.